Hello and welcome to my YouTube channel Sinan Academy. This is lecture number 2 for the video lecture series on transformer. In previous lecture we have discussed about ideal transformer. We have drawn phasor diagram of ideal transformer on no load as well as on load. We have also discussed the MMF balance equation of ideal transformer. In this lecture we will be covering the following topics. We will draw the exact equivalent circuit diagram of transformer. Then we will draw the phasor diagram of transformer on load as well as on no load. Then we will understand the concept of referred values and draw the approximate equivalent circuit diagram of transformer referred to primary side as well as referred to secondary side. After that we will learn two very important tests carried out on transformer, and these are open circuit test and short circuit test. So let us start this lecture. Before drawing the equivalent circuit diagram, let us first understand what is the difference between ideal transformer and a practical transformer. In ideal transformer, we have seen there are no losses, the permeability of the core is infinite, and there is no any leakage flux. Now in case of practical transformer, we have losses, copper loss and iron loss is present. The permeability of a practical transformer is definite. That is why the reluctance of practical transformer is non-zero. And in this case, in practical transformer, the leakage flux is also present. So now, here let us discuss a very important concept of MMF balance equation of practical transformer. In case of ideal transformer, we have seen the permeability of the core is infinite, so very negligible amount of magnetizing current is required for the production of flux. But here in case of practical transformer, the permeability is definite, that is the core has non-zero reluctance. It means there is some reluctance present inside the core of the transformer. In this case, significant amount of magnetizing current is required for the production of flux. Another point is that since ideal transformer has no iron loss, so at no load also there is no any extra current required to feed the iron loss or core loss. But here iron loss is present. So this iron loss is also occurring at no load, because in no load condition also the flux is inside the core of the transformer, and due to that alternating flux there is a core loss inside the core of the transformer. So in case of practical transformer, since core loss is present, we require some amount of current to feed that core loss. So at no load condition, in case of practical transformer, there are two component of current required. One is for magnetizing current, one is for production of flux in the inside the core of the transformer, and second component is the component which is feeding core loss inside the core of the transformer. So we say that in no load condition, the no load current is required to produce the no load current is required to produce flux in the core and for core losses. So MMF balance equation in case of practical transformer is slightly different. We have N1 I1 minus N2 I2 is not equal to 0. Here it is equal to N1 into I0, where this I0 is called as no load current. Okay, so if we rearrange the quantities, we get I1 primary current is equal to N2 by N1 into I2 plus I0, where this N2 by N1 into I0 I2 is called as I2 dash. So primary current I1 is the sum of phasor sum of two currents. One is I2 dash, another is I0. This I0 is also called as exciting current in case of transformer. This I2 dash here is the secondary current referred to the primary side. We will later on in this video understand that what is the meaning of referred values. We will understand the concept of referred values in this video lecture. Now let us move forward. Let us draw the equivalent circuit diagram of transformer now. Okay. we will develop the equivalent circuit diagram of transformer on no load. Okay, let us take an ideal transformer. We will develop the equivalent circuit diagram of transformer by adding the losses in the ideal transformer. Okay, because ideal transformer has no loss, but practical transformer has copper loss as well as iron loss. So we'll add these losses to the ideal transformer to make it a practical transformer. So this is the ideal transformer which I have just shown on the screen. Okay, now let us add the copper loss in the ideal transformer. We know that copper loss is occurring in primary winding as well as in secondary winding. So we will show copper loss in equivalent circuit diagram by resistance, by equivalent resistance. We cannot show copper loss, so we show that copper loss by an equivalent resistance. Moreover, all the power losses, P, which is active power loss, is shown by resistance only. Okay, so in this case also, the copper loss or active power loss in the primary winding as well as in secondary winding is shown by primary resistance as well as secondary resistance. Okay, so let us add the resistances. This is R1 in the primary side and this is R2 in the secondary side. Now in case of ideal transformer, there is no any leakage flux, but here in case of practical transformer, we have leakage flux also. So we will add leakage flux in this case also, but flux cannot be added in a circuit diagram. So we will use reactance to represent the leakage flux, and that reactance is called as leakage reactance. So there is a leakage flux in primary side as well as in the secondary side. So we represent that leakage flux by a leakage reactance. So X1 is the leakage reactance of primary side and X2 is the leakage reactance of secondary side. Now let us represent core loss also. In case of practical transformer, iron loss is present, iron loss or core loss is present. So we represent that core loss in ideal, we represent that core loss in practical transformer also. So how can we represent that core loss and where should we represent that core loss? In order to understand that, we know that core loss or iron loss is dependent upon the applied voltage or voltage. In this case, the induced voltage in the primary winding is E1. We will represent that also. So the core loss is proportional to the induced EMF in the primary winding. Okay. So we will show that core loss, or we will show equivalent resistance representing the core loss in parallel with the induced EMF in the primary winding. Since this is a primary phenomena, that's why we represent the core loss in the primary side only. Okay. So let us represent core loss resistance in parallel with the primary induced EMF. So this is RC, which is representing the core loss of the transformer. Now one last thing we need to represent, and that is magnetizing reactance. And magnetizing reactance is obviously representing the magnetizing flux of the core of the transformer. So magnetizing flux is also dependent upon the induced EMF in the primary side. We know, we have derived the EMF equation of transformer, and we get E is equal to root 2 pi n f phi m. So root 2 pi n f is constant. Okay, so phi m is proportional to the induced EMF E. Okay, so we show that magnetizing reactance in parallel with the induced EMF itself. So we'll add X phi in parallel to the RC. Okay, so these are the parameters of practical transformer: X1, R1, X5, RC, R2 and X2. Okay, now when we apply voltage in the primary side, current will start flowing in the primary winding. Okay, so this is the current I1 in the primary side, and we know that in case of no load, only no load current flows through the primary winding of the transformer. So this no load current has two components, which we have discussed just in the previous slide, that in case of no load condition, the current has two components, one that is required for the production of flux and another is which is feeding the core loss of the transformer. So this no load current has two components. One is called as magnetizing component of no load current and another is called as core loss component of the no load current. And now let us represent the induced EMFs. So E1 is the induced EMF in the primary side, E2 is the induced EMF in secondary side, and V2 is the secondary terminal voltage. Now in no load condition, there is no current on the secondary side. So I2 will be 0. Since this is open circuit, so I2 will be 0. And the current referred, this current I2 referred to primary side, I2 dash will also be 0. Okay. So we can say at no load condition, this I1 and I0 are equal. Here we get this. Okay. I1 is equal to I0. Now let us draw the phasor diagram of practical transformer on no load. So this is the circuit diagram of transformer, equivalent circuit diagram of transformer on no load. So how many phasors we need to draw? Let us see. We have V1, I1, I0, I5, IC, E1, E2 and V2. So there are 8 phasors. So we need to represent these 8 phasors on the phasor diagram. Okay. We have already discussed that in order to draw the phasor diagram of transformer, we used to take phi m as a reference phasor. Okay. So in this case also, we will take phi m as a reference phasor. Okay. Now, after drawing phi m, we will draw E1 and E2. Okay. So E1 is the induced EMF in the primary side. And we know that this induced EMF, E1, will lead the flux phi m by an angle of 90 degree. So let us draw E1 by taking angle 90 degree in anti-clockwise direction. Okay. So this is E1. Now in case of ideal transformer, we have seen this E1 is equal to V1. Why? Because there is no any primary impedance. But here we have primary impedance as R1 and JX1. So where will be this V1? In this case, under no load condition, the no load current is only flowing through the primary impedance, that is I0. Okay. And in practical transformer also, this R1 and X1 are very low. This is done in order to save the power loss in case of practical transformer. R1 is kept very low and windings are kept in such a way that the leakage reactance should be minimum. Okay. So this R1 and X1 are kept very low in case of practical transformer also. Now this no load current is also very low. It is only 2-5% of full load rated current, and this impedance is also low. So the voltage drop in primary winding under no load condition is very low. So we can consider under no load condition this V1 and E1 to be equal. So in phasor diagram also we will represent V1 equal to E1. So E1 is equal to V1 in under no load condition. Okay. So now let us draw the E2. E2 will also lead phi m by an angle of 90 degree. And in this case, since there is no current on the secondary side, I2 is 0. So there will be no drop in the secondary impedance. So E2 will be equal to V2. Okay. Now let us draw I5, IC and I0. Where to draw I5? Since I5 is responsible for the production of flux, so we will show that I5 in phase with the phi m. So this is I5. Now we know that the core loss is dependent upon the primary induced EMF E1. So this core loss component of no load current will also be shown in phase with the E1. Okay. Now after adding the phasors IC and I5, we will get the no load current I0, and in this case I0 is equal to I1, and the angle between this V1 and I0 is called as no load power factor angle, phi0. Okay. One more thing here, what is this angle called as? This angle is called as hysteretic angle, the angle between no load current I0 and the flux phi m. Okay. So we learned that there are two components of no load current. One is called as magnetizing component of no load current, and another is called as core loss component of no load current. At no load condition, this current I0 is responsible for the production of flux as well as to feed the core loss. Okay. Now, after drawing the phasor diagram of transformer on no load, we will draw the phasor diagram of transformer on load now. For that, we will first see the equivalent circuit diagram of transformer at load condition. Okay. And we will also write the KVL equation of primary side as well as KVL equation of secondary side. So this is the no load circuit diagram of transformer. Now we connect load on the secondary side. As we connect load on the secondary side, there will be a current on the secondary side called as I2. Okay. So this I2 will now be non-zero. So I2 dash will be non-zero because I2 dash is the secondary current referred to the primary side. Okay. So now when we connect the load, there will be current in the secondary side. So let us write the EMF equation or let us apply KVL in the secondary side. When we apply KVL in the secondary side, we will get this equation. E2 is equal to V2 plus I2 R2 plus J I2 into X2. Now when we apply KVL on the primary side, we will get this equation. V1 is equal to E1 plus I1 R1 plus J I1 X1. And also we know that I0 is equal to the phasor sum of two currents I5 and IC. Okay. And one more thing to remember here, that I1 primary current is equal to I2 dash plus I0. If you apply KCL at this node, we will get I1 is equal to I2 dash plus I0. Okay. Now let us draw the phasor diagram of transformer at load. For drawing the phasor diagram of the transformer at load, let us take the load as power factor of the load is cos phi lag. Okay. So phi is the power factor angle. So I2 lag V2 by an angle of phi. Okay. So before drawing the phasor diagram, let us write the KVL equations of primary and secondary side. So these are KVL equations. V1 is equal to E1 plus I1 R1 plus J I1 X1. E2 is equal to V2 plus I2 R2 plus J I2 X2. And this is the KCL equation I0 is equal to I5 plus IC. Okay. Now in order to draw the phasor diagram of transformer, we will take phi m as a reference. In this case also, we will take phi m as a reference. So let us first draw phi m. Okay. After drawing phi m, what we do? We draw E1 and E2. So E1 will be leading the phi m by an angle of 90 degree. Now in this case, E1 will not be equal to V1. Why? Because in this case, this I1 is not equal to I0. I1 is now equal to I2 dash plus I0. So there will be a significant drop inside the primary impedance. Okay. So we will not take E1 is equal to V1. We will find out where this V1 could be. Okay. Now this is E1. Now after that, we will draw E2 also. We have taken E1 larger than E2. We have taken step down transformers. That's why we are taking E1 larger than E2. Okay. So we have drawn E2 in phase with E1. Now let us draw this no load current I0. For drawing no load current I0, we need to first draw I5 and IC. So I5 will be in phase with the phi m and IC will be in phase with E1. So after adding these two currents, we will get I0. Okay. Now after drawing I0, let us draw other phases. The first phasor which we draw after I0 is I2. Now the question is where we can draw this phasor I2. We know that I2 lags V2 by an angle of phi. We have taken cos phi lag load. Okay. So if we have V2, we can draw I2. But currently we don't have V2 also. So how can we draw I2 now? Now let us see this equation. If the load is lagging, this V2 will be lagging the voltage E2, because E2 is the phasor sum of three voltages, V2, I2 R2 and I2 X2. So this E2 is the phasor sum of all these phasors. So we say that practically you will find that this V2 will be lagging the E2. Okay. So V2 will be lagging E2 and I2 will be lagging V2. So I2 will be lagging E2, we can say. So let us draw I2 lagging V2 like this. Okay. Now as we get I2, we can draw I2 dash. I2 dash will be equal to I2 by A. and it will be in phase with I2. So this is I2 dash. Now as we have got I2 dash and I0, we can find what is I1. We can easily find out. We can phasor sum these two phasors to get the I1. So let us add these two phasors to get I1. Okay. So now we get I1. After this, let us take V2 now. So where could be this V2? V2 will be in between E2 and I2, because V2 is leading I2 and V2 is lagging E2. So V2 will be somewhere in between E2 and I2. So let us draw V2 like this. Okay. And we know that I2 is lagging the voltage V2 by an angle of phi. Now, if we add these two phasors I2 R2 and JI2 X2 in V2, we will arrive at E2. So we will add these two phasors in V2 in such a way we will arrive at E2. Okay. So where we add this I2 R2 now, and I2 R2 will be in phase or in the direction of I2. So this I2 R2 drop will be added to V2 in the direction of I2 like this. Okay. Now where this JI2 X2? JI2 X2 will be 90 degree in anti-clockwise direction with current I2. Okay. So we add this phasor JI2 X2 90 degree in anti-clockwise direction with I2. So we can add this JI2 X2 like this. So when we add JI2 X2 into I2 R2, we will arrive at E2. So the complete phasor diagram will be like this. V2 plus I2 R2 plus JI2 X2 is equal to E2. Okay. So now we have drawn all the phasors on the secondary side now. Okay. So let us move to the primary side. We have this E1 now. So if we add these two phasors I1 R1 and JI1 X1 to E1, we will arrive at V1. Okay. So how can we do that? We have this I1. Okay. So we add this drop I1 R1 in the direction of I1 to the phasor E1 like this. So I1 R1 is the phasor added to phasor E1 in the direction of I1. And in the similar manner, JI1 X1 will be added to this phasor I1 R1 90 degree in anti-clockwise direction with I1. It will be added like this. Okay. So we got E1 plus I1 R1 plus JI1 X1 is equal to V1. So now you can see here that we have all the phasors on the phasor diagram now. So now we have drawn a very important phasor diagram of transformer, and that is the diagram, phasor diagram of transformer on load. I have taken the load power factor as cos phi lag. Now I would request all the viewers to practice the phasor diagram of transformer on lag load as well as on lead load. Okay. First try to practice this phasor diagram 2 or 3 times so that you can get a confidence to draw the phasor diagram, and then after that try to draw the phasor diagram of transformer on load also. Okay. So this is all about the phasor diagram of transformer on load. Now after that we will discuss the concept of referred values. So for discussing the referred values, let us take a transformer in which a load, Z load, is connected on the secondary side. Okay. So you can see in this transformer, this is an ideal transformer. There is no any leakage reactance or resistance or anything else. Only the impedance Z load is connected on the secondary side. Okay. And we know that V1 by V2 is equal to I2 by I1 is equal to A. So from this relation, we get V2 is equal to V1 by A and I2 is equal to A into I1. Okay. So this Z load, which is the load impedance, can be written as the ratio of this voltage and current V2 and I2. So Z load is equal to V2 by I2. Okay. So this V2 is now can be replaced by V1 by A, and I2 is replaced by A times of I1. So we can write like this. Z load is equal to V1 by A upon A into I1. So this will be equal to 1 upon A square into V1 by I1. Now if I ask you, what is this V1 by I1? V1 by I1 is the impedance seen from the primary side. Let us call it as Z1. So Z load will be equal to Z1 upon A square, where Z1 is V1 upon I1. So we can rearrange the quantities to get Z1 is equal to A square times of Z load. So what is this Z1 now? See, in this whole circuit diagram, there is only one impedance, and that is Z load. It means if you see this Z load from primary side, which is equal to Z1, so you will get A square times of Z load. The total impedance is A square times of Z load. So we can say this Z load referred to primary side. Z load referred to primary side is equal to Z load dash. Okay. So Z dash, Z load dash is equal to A square times of Z load. So this Z load dash is called as secondary load impedance referred to primary side. So referred value means we are seeing one quantity of one side of the transformer to the other side of the transformer. Okay. Like here we are seeing Z load, which is on the secondary side, and we are seeing this Z load from the primary side. So that Z load which is seen from the primary side is called as referred impedance. Okay, or referred Z load. So that referred value is shown by dash. So Z dash means it is referred to either primary or secondary. Since Z load is connected in the secondary side, so Z dash load will be secondary load impedance referred to the primary side. Okay, if some quantity, like say for example E1 here, E1 is the primary quantity. If we refer this primary quantity to secondary side, we say it is E1 dash. So we know that E1 is primary, so E1 dash will be primary induced EMF referred to secondary side. Now if you write V2 dash, so what that V2 dash will be? We know that V2 is the secondary terminal voltage. So V2 dash will be secondary terminal voltage referred to primary side. So by only applying dash, we can name that quantity, whether it will be referred to primary or it will be referred to secondary. Okay. Take one more example. If we have I1 dash, so what is that I1 dash is? We know that I1 is the primary current. So I1 dash will be primary current referred to secondary side. Okay. Now let us draw the equivalent circuit diagram referred to primary side or referred to secondary side. So first we will draw the equivalent circuit diagram of transformer referred to primary side. Okay. So for that, this is the KVL equation of secondary side. E2 is equal to V2 plus I2 R2 plus JI2 X2. Now, if we multiply this by A, we will get A into E2 plus A V2 plus A I2 R2 plus JA I2 into X2. So what is this A times of E2 now? This will be E2 dash. And what is A times of V2 now? It will be V2 dash. Means secondary load voltage referred to primary, secondary induced voltage referred to primary. Okay, so we can write it like this, and this E2 dash will be equal to V1 induced EMF in the primary side. We are seeing this E2 from the primary side, so it will be equal to E1. So E1 will be equal to E2 dash, which is equal to V2 dash plus I2 A I2 R2 plus JA I2 X2. Now if we multiply and divide by A, we get this equation. This A square times of R2 and A square times of X2 is now the referred value of the resistance and reactance on the primary side. Just like impedance, we have seen in the previous slide that A square times of Z load is equal to Z dash load. So here also A square times of R2 is the R2 dash, and A square times of X2 will be X2 dash. So X2 is the quantity on the secondary side. So X2 dash will be the quantity on the primary side, referred on the primary side. Okay. So X2 dash and R2 dash are the secondary quantities referred to the primary side. And one more thing, we have I2 by A. We have already seen it. This I2 by A is I2 dash, the secondary current referred to the primary side. So let us write this equation in primary referred form, and that E1 is equal to E2 dash, which is equal to V2 dash plus I2 dash R2 dash plus JI2 dash X2 dash. Now here each and every quantity is now of the primary side. So we can now draw the equivalent circuit diagram of transformer referred to the primary side. This is the equivalent circuit diagram of transformer of primary side. Now if you refer the secondary side to the primary side, we apply dash on all the quantities. So R2 dash, JX2 dash, I2 dash, V2 dash and E2 dash. These are the secondary referred quantities to the primary side. So R2 dash is the secondary resistance referred to the primary side. X2 dash will be the secondary leakage reactance referred to the primary side. I2 dash is the secondary current referred to the primary side. V2 dash is the secondary terminal voltage referred to the primary side. And E2 dash will be secondary induced EMF referred to the primary side. Okay. So I have drawn the equivalent circuit diagram of transformer referred to the primary side. In the similar manner, you can draw circuit diagram of transformer referred to secondary side also. In secondary side only, you will apply the dash on the primary quantities. V1 dash, I1 dash, X1 dash, R1 dash, I0 dash, I5 dash, IC dash, X5 dash and RC dash and E1 dash also. Okay. Now by just applying dash on every quantity of primary side, we will say it will be the referred quantity of the primary side to the secondary side. Okay. So you can draw on your own. I have just drawn the referred circuit diagram on primary side. You can draw this referred quantities on secondary side also. Okay. Now let us draw the approximate equivalent circuit diagram of the transformer. Before drawing the approximate equivalent circuit diagram of the transformer, we will first understand that why we do approximation. The approximation is done in order to reduce the complexity of the network or complexity of the calculation. Okay. And how can we do that? We can do approximation by some justification. Means, by doing approximation, the result must not vary much, or it must be very close to actual value. After approximation, the result that we obtained, it must be very close to the result. If the result which you obtained after approximation is not very much different from the actual result, so we can say that this approximation can be applied. So in this case also, we will first see what are the approximation that we can do here, and we will justify it that after doing this approximation, the result will be almost same. Okay. So the first approximation is that the shunt branch will be shifted before the primary impedance. Okay. So we can do like this. We just shift this shunt branch before the primary impedance. Now let us analyze the approximation. Before the approximation, the current flowing through this primary impedance is I1. Okay. Now after shifting this shunt branch before the primary impedance, the current which is flowing through this primary impedance is now I2 dash. Okay. So I1, we know that I1 is larger than I2 dash. So we can say the copper loss corresponding to this current I2 dash, which is equal to I2 dash square into R1, is less as compared to the copper loss corresponding to the current I1, which is equal to I1 square into R1. So we say that copper loss is reduced. Copper loss is reduced. After approximation, copper loss is reduced. Now, when this shunt branch is before the primary impedance, this E1 will be across the RC, across the core loss resistance RC. So in this case, we say that the core loss is proportional to the induced EMF E1. Now when the shunt branch is moved before the primary impedance, the voltage V1 will be across the RC. So the core loss will now be proportional to V1. And we know that in a practical transformer, this V1 is larger than E1. So before approximation, the core loss is proportional to E1. And after approximation, this core loss will be proportional to V1. So we say that since V1 is larger than E1, the core loss PC has increased. Because it is proportional to E1 before approximation, and after approximation, it will be proportional to V1 now. So since V1 is larger than E1, we say the core loss has increased now. So now you can see at one place, loss is decreased, and at another place the loss is increased. So by this approximation, we can say the overall effect can be nullified. That copper loss is decreased and iron loss is increased, so overall effect can be nullified. So this approximation is now justified. Okay, there will be not much difference between the actual result and the result obtained after the approximation. So this approximation is almost justified. Now after doing approximation, what we get? We get very easy circuit. This R1 will be now in series with the R2 dash, and this X1 will now be in series with the X2 dash. Now we can combine these resistance and reactances. So let us combine these two. R2 dash will be combined with R1, so it will be R1E, which is equal to R1 plus R2 dash, and now this X2 dash plus X1 will be equal to X1E. So in place of four quantities, we have only two, R and X. So there is only one impedance, which is called as Z1E. What is Z1E? Z1 is the primary equivalent leakage impedance. Okay. Now let us do one more approximation. This is the circuit which we obtained after first approximation. Now in second approximation, we just neglect this shunt branch. And why we do that? Let us understand that. We know that I1 is equal to I0 plus I2 dash. Okay. And this I0 is very less as compared to the full load rated current. So the no load current I0 as compared to the current I1 is very less. So we can neglect this I0. Since I0 is very small, we can neglect this I0. So that is, we put I0 is equal to 0. So we say that if I0 is 0, I1 will be equal to almost I2 dash. Okay. So we can now remove this shunt branch such that I1 will now be equal to I2 dash. So this will be the equivalent circuit diagram after second approximation. So now you can see this is a very simple diagram, equivalent circuit diagram, and it is very convenient to do calculations on this circuit. We have removed the nodes, we have removed the different parameters, we have combined these parameters R1, X1 with X2 and R2. Okay, so we obtain only one single impedance. So we represent the whole transformer by only a single impedance, that is Z1E, which is equal to R1E plus JX1E. Okay. Now this is the approximated equivalent circuit diagram referred to the primary side, because we have used V2 dash. It means the dash quantity is on V2. So it will be the secondary load impedance, secondary load voltage referred to primary side. Okay. So it will be a circuit diagram referred to the primary side. So this is the circuit diagram, approximate equivalent circuit diagram referred to the primary. Now we can draw the approximate equivalent circuit diagram referred to secondary side also. So this is the referred circuit diagram to secondary side. In this case, this R2E and X2E will be like this. R2E will be equal to R1 dash, because R1 now will be referred to the secondary side, and R2 will be on the secondary side itself. So R1 dash plus R2 is equal to R2E, and X1 dash plus X2 is equal to X2E. Okay. So these are the two approximated equivalent circuit diagram of the transformer referred to primary and referred to secondary side. After this, let us draw the phasor diagram of transformer for this circuit. So let us take the circuit diagram of transformer referred to secondary side. This is what the equivalent circuit diagram, approximated equivalent circuit diagram of transformer referred to secondary side. Now let us connect the load on the secondary side. Okay. So in this case, for drawing the phasor diagram of the transformer, we will not take phi m as a reference. Why? Because there is no any representation of phi m here. In this case, we will take V2 as a reference. Okay. Now let us apply KVL here. If you apply KVL, you will get this V1 dash is equal to V2 plus I2 RE2, I2 R2E plus J I2 X2E. Now let us draw the phasor diagram now. So you must have learned that how to draw the phasor diagram. What are the things required to draw the phasor diagram? First thing is circuit diagram, and second thing is KVL or KCL equations. Okay. So these are the two very important quantities required for drawing the phasor diagram. Okay, so let us start drawing the phasor diagram of this secondary referred circuit diagram for the transformer. So we'll take V2 as a reference. So let us draw V2 first, and let us take load as cos phi lag load. Okay, so I2 will be lagging V2. So let us take I2 lagging V2 by an angle of phi. Now after having I2, we can have this drop I2 R2E and J I2 X2E. So I2 R2E will be in the same direction with I2, and we will add this I2 R2E with V2. It will be like this. Okay. Now where this J I2 X2E will be added, this J I2 X2E will be added 90 clockwise direction with I2. So it will be like this. Okay. Now if we add these phasors I2 R2E and J I2 X2E, we will get V1 dash. One more thing here, if we see very carefully, this I2 R2E and J I2 X2E is equal to I2 Z2E also, where Z2E is the impedance of the transformer referred to the secondary side. So Z2E will be equal to R2E plus JX2E. So if we multiply that Z2E with I2, we'll get this I2 Z2E added to this phasor V2. So we will get this phasor V1 dash. Okay. So this is the phasor diagram of the transformer for the approximated equivalent circuit diagram. Okay. Refer to the secondary side. Now after drawing the phasor diagrams at different conditions, let us move forward. So after that, we will discuss the tests which are carried out on the transformer. What are those tests? Number one is open circuit test, and number two is short circuit test. So first we will discuss open circuit test. So what is open circuit test is actually? It is the test carried out on the transformer on no load, means secondary side is open circuited. That is why the name open circuit is given to this test, because secondary terminal is open circuit. Now before discussing this open circuit or short circuit test, let us discuss why the tests are being carried out on the transformer. So the test, either the short circuit or open circuit test, are carried out on transformer to predict its performance without actually loading it. Means before putting the transformer actually inside the distribution system or in the power system, we first predict the performance in the lab itself by performing different tests. So these are two of those tests. One is open circuit test, another is short circuit test. Okay, now let us understand this open circuit test now. So open circuit test is carried out at rated frequency and rated voltage in order to determine core loss. We know that the core loss is dependent on frequency as well as on voltage. So if we change the frequency or voltage, the core loss will change. So that is why in order to get exact value of core loss, we should carry out this test at rated frequency and rated voltage, because we are measuring the core loss. So we cannot change the frequency and voltage. So open circuit test has to be carried out at rated voltage and rated frequency. Open circuit test is usually carried out with the instruments placed on the low voltage side, while the high voltage side is kept open circuit. And why we do that? We do that because it is easier to arrange rated voltage supply, because if the voltage is low, it is very easy to arrange. And the instruments are also cheaper. Why? Because the voltage which is designed for high voltage side will have a very heavy insulation also inside themselves. That is why the cost will be higher. So if we apply the instruments on the low voltage side, or if we connect the instruments on the low voltage side, they will be cheaper as compared to the instruments connected on the high voltage side. And one more very important point is that it is safer to work on the low voltage side than to work on the high voltage side. We need to connect the instruments, so we need to work on the low voltage side only. We don't need to go to the high voltage side. Okay. Now, in order to carry out this open circuit test, we connect three instruments in the transformer. And what are that? First is voltmeter, second ammeter, and third one is wattmeter. Now, wattmeter is of two type. One is to measure the power for a low power factor circuit, and another is to measure the power for the high power factor circuit. Now under short circuit or open circuit condition, power factor of the transformer is very low. That is why we use a low power factor wattmeter. Okay, since phi naught is very small, since power factor is very small, that is why we use a low power factor wattmeter. Okay, now let us see the connection diagram of the transformer at open circuit test. So this is how all the equipments are connected. You can see the instruments V and wattmeter and ammeter are connected on low voltage side, and HV side is kept open circuited. We will apply rated frequency and adjustable voltage supply. We can just adjust the voltage to the rated voltage, but frequency has to be kept at rated value. We will first start adjusting the voltage and move it to the rated value. Okay, since this open circuit is carried out at rated voltage, so we'll adjust the voltage to the rated supply only. Okay, now let us see what will be the equivalent circuit diagram of the transformer at open circuit, during open circuit test. Okay, so this is the exact equivalent circuit diagram of the transformer of the primary side. Since secondary side is open circuited, so no need to bother about the equivalent circuit diagram of the secondary side, because there will be no current on the secondary side. Okay, that is why I have just shown the circuit diagram of the primary side only. This is the primary phenomena. Okay, now in this case you can see this no load current I naught is flowing through the primary impedance R1 plus JX1. Okay, now a very important point to be noted here. Since I naught is very small, therefore the power measured may be considered to be represent only core loss, as the primary copper loss corresponding to such a small current would be negligible. Since I naught is flowing through this R1 also, so the copper loss corresponding to this no load current I1 will be equal to I naught square into R1. And we know that in practical transformer also, R1 is kept very low and no load current is also very low. So the product I naught square into R1 is very low. We can neglect this I naught square into R1 under this condition. So we will say that the power measured by the wattmeter is corresponding to only the core loss of the transformer. One more very important point here. The voltage drop across the primary impedance is extremely low and can be neglected. Since I naught is the only current flowing through this primary impedance and primary impedance is kept low, so the voltage drop I naught into Z1 is also very low. So we can say this VOC, open circuit voltage, is now across the shunt branch. Okay, by neglecting this R1 plus JX1. Now let us neglect this R1 and JX1. We can do that by short circuiting these two quantities. So now you can see very easily the open circuit test, the equivalent circuit under open circuit test condition will be very simple. We have only shunt branch now. So we have only two parameters to be find out, that is X5 and RC. So how can we do that? We can do that by these formulas. We know that RC is equal to VOC square upon POC, and also phi naught is equal to cos inverse POC upon VOC into IC. So we can find X5 now. X5 is equal to RC upon tan phi naught. Okay, so we can find RC and X5 using this formula now. One more shortcut method is also available. Let us find YOC now. YOC is the open circuit admittance looking from the secondary terminal, or looking from this terminal. Okay, so YOC will be equal to the current I divided by V. Here in this case the current is IOC and the voltage is VOC. Angle minus cos inverse POC upon VOC into IOC. Okay, so we will get GC minus JB phi. What is this GC? GC is called as conductance and B phi is called as susceptance. So by taking the reciprocals of GC and B phi, we will get RC and X5. Okay, so after discussing about the open circuit test, let us solve one numerical problem based on open circuit test. So this is the question. The question says the instruments connected at low voltage side during open circuit test, the readings for 10 kilovolt ampere, 450 volt by 120 volt 50 hertz transformer are 120 volt, 4.2 ampere and 80 watt. find the resistances and reactance of equivalent exciting circuit referred to HV side. So the question is asking about the resistance and reactance of exciting circuit, means that shunt branch. Okay, and this 120 volt is V0, 4.2 ampere is I0, and 80 volt is P0, means these are the quantities at open circuit condition, and these are the quantities of low voltage side, because these instruments, wattmeter, voltmeter and ammeter, are kept on the low voltage side under open circuit condition. Okay, now let us solve this question. First we will find the voltage ratio or turns ratio or transformation ratio. This A is equal to 450 upon 120, because the transformation ratio will be equal to the voltage ratio, 450 upon 120, which will be equal to 15/4. Now what are the given quantities? We have open circuit power, POC is equal to 80 watt, VOC is equal to 120, and I0 is equal to 4.2 amperes. Okay, now let us find out RC and XY now. So RC will be equal to VOC square upon POC, which is equal to 120 square upon 80, so it will be equal to 180 ohms, and this RC will be of low voltage side, because all quantities VOC and POC is of low voltage side, so that is why this 180 ohm is the RC of low voltage side. So now we can now refer this quantity RC of low voltage side to high voltage side. So in order to refer this to high voltage side, we will multiply it by A square, so it will be equal to 15/4 square into 180, which is equal to 2.53 kilo ohm. So RC, which is referred to high voltage side, will be represented by RC dash. So RC dash of HV side will be 15/4 square into 180, which is equal to 2.53 kilo ohm. Now for finding out XY, we need phi naught. So we first find phi naught. Phi naught will be equal to cos inverse POC upon VOC into I naught. So it will be equal to 80.87 degree. So XY, which is of low voltage side, it will be equal to RC upon tan phi naught. So RC of low voltage side is 180, so 180 upon tan 80.87, it is equal to 28.93 ohm. So now XY will be, XY for high voltage side will be 15/4 square into A square into 28.93, so it is equal to 406.83. So these are the two quantities, one is RC, another is XY, is for high voltage side, which is equal to RC of high voltage side is 2.53 kilo ohm, and XY of high voltage side is 406.83 ohm. Now let us discuss the short circuit test now. So short circuit test is carried out at rated current to determine the full load copper loss. Since resistance is not affected too much by frequency at lower frequencies, so this test may be carried out at frequency even slightly different from the rated frequency. But in case of open circuit test, we have seen that the frequency must not vary, because as you change the frequency, the core loss will change. And in open circuit test, we are measuring core loss, so we'll get a different core loss if we change the frequency, we'll not get the actual core loss. But in this case, at short circuit condition, we are measuring the copper loss, and copper loss is dependent upon resistance. So if we change frequency slightly, the resistance, the value of resistance is not going to be affected. So the copper loss is not changed. So we can carry out this short circuit test at a frequency slightly different from the rated frequency. So it's not a problem here. Frequency is not a problem here. Okay. Now, this short circuit test is usually carried out with the instrument placed on high voltage side, while the low voltage side is short circuited by a thick wire for a low resistance wire. Okay. And why here in this case the instruments are placed at the high voltage side? It is because the rated current on high voltage side is lower as compared to LV side. Therefore, cost saving would be obtained on the instruments, because if we keep that instrument at high voltage side, so the full load rated current for a high voltage side is low. But if we keep that instrument on the low voltage side, the current will be very high. So we must have to arrange those instruments which can sustain that much high current. So the cost will be higher. That is why we connect all the instruments at the high voltage side. Now one more point. Under short circuit condition, only a very small amount of voltage as compared to rated voltage is required to flow the short circuit current or the rated current. So, we say at that small value of applied voltage, the core loss is very low because core loss is proportional to the square of applied voltage. So, if the voltage is reduced very much, it is almost 5 to 10% of the rated voltage. So, at that low voltage, the core loss is very low. So, under short circuit condition, we can say that the wattmeter which is measuring the power is only measuring the copper loss of the transformer. So, the voltage required to circulate full load current at short circuit is only 5 to 10%. So, under short circuit condition, core loss can be ignored. Okay. Now, let us move to the connection diagram of the transformer under short circuit test. So, now you can see from here, we have instrument connected on the high voltage side and low voltage side is short circuited. And we have here adjustable voltage supply. Okay. Rated frequency may or may not be required. Now, let us move to the equivalent circuit diagram of the transformer under short circuit test. So, this is the exact equivalent circuit diagram of transformer. Okay. Now, we have short circuited the secondary terminal. After short circuiting the secondary terminal, we can see the full load current is flowing only under 5 to 10% of, only by applying 5 to 10% of rated voltage. Okay. Now, when the applied voltage is only 5 to 10% of full load rated voltage, we can neglect this no load current I0. Why so? Let us discuss that. At rated voltage, the no load current which will be flowing through the shunt branch is only 2 to 5% of full load rated current. And it is when the voltage is rated. Now, when the voltage is reduced to 5 to 10% of V rated, that is rated voltage, now you can imagine what is the value of no load current now. It will be very, very less. So, this and the current on the secondary side is full load current. So, now in this case, it is very convenient to just ignore this no load current I0 because no load current is very, very, very small as compared to full load current under short circuit condition. So, if we neglect that I0, means ISC, short circuit current on the primary side will be equal to I2 full load on the secondary side. Okay. So, this I0 will be neglected. So, we can neglect this shunt branch. So, now we can neglect this shunt branch. So, we have a circuit in which two resistances are in series and two reactances are in series. So, let us combine these two resistances and reactances now. So, it will be combined and resistance will be combined and we will obtain a very simple equivalent circuit diagram now. So, let us find out how we can, let us see how we can find out this X equivalent and R equivalent now. So, from here you can see, if we find the Z equivalent, it will be equal to the ratio of voltage to the current. So, Z equivalent will be equal to VSC upon ISC. And the angle is cos inverse PSC upon VSC into ISC. So, from here we can obtain R equivalent and X equivalent. Okay. Now, let us solve one numerical problem on short circuit test also. So, the question says, the instrument connected at HV side during short circuit test, the readings for 50 kilovolt ampere, 2400 volt / 240 volt, 50 hertz transformer are 48 volt, 20.8 amperes and 617 watt. Here you can see very clearly that the voltage at short circuit condition is only 48 volts. And we know that the voltmeter is connected at the high voltage side. So, high voltage side rated voltage is 2400 volts. So, you can see here, this 48 voltage is very, very less as compared to the full load rated voltage of high voltage side. So, this 48 volt is more than enough to flow the rated current, that is equal to 20.8 amperes. And this is the power measured at short circuit condition. Now, the question is asking to find the leakage impedance and effective resistance and leakage reactance referred to LV side. That is, we need to find the series parameters referred to the LV side. So let us in this case also write the A will be equal to 2400 upon 240, which is equal to 10. Now the given parameters are PSC is 617 watt, VSC has 48 volt, and ISC is 20.8 amperes. So we can find Z equivalent referred to high voltage side, or Z equivalent of high voltage side. It is equal to VSC upon ISC angle cos inverse PSC upon VSC into ISC. So we'll get Z equivalent as Z is equivalent equal to 1.426 plus J 1.814 ohms. Now when we refer this Z equivalent to low voltage side, so we'll divide it by A square. So we are not going to divide this by A square. A is 10, so A square will be 10 square. So Z equivalent will be equal to 14.26 plus J 18.14 milli ohms. Okay, so this is the R equivalent of low voltage side, referred to low voltage side, and this is the X equivalent of low voltage side. Okay, so R equivalent will be equal to 14.26 milli ohm and X equivalent equal to 18.14 milli ohms. So this is all for the today's lecture, and thanks for watching my videos on YouTube.